Any health-related information on the following show provides general information only. Content presented on any show, by any host, or by any guest should not be substituted for a doctor's advice. Always consult your physician before you begin any new diet, exercise, or training program. And thank you for listening to the Whole Care Network.
Welcome to Healing Ties on the Whole Care Network. On Healing Ties, we're creating a life to love after caregiving ends by sharing stories and resources and being with awesome people like you. Now that caregiving has ended, let the Healing Ties begin. Here's your host, Chris McClellan, the Bowtie Guy.
Well, greetings, everyone. It's Chris McClellan, the Bowtie Guy, for another episode of Healing Ties. Thanks for joining me this morning. And certainly want to send a hello and a shout out to all of our friends in the UK on UKHealthRadio.com. Thanks for your support and all your suggestions for the show. And goodness, I have quite the surprise today for all of our listeners in the UK, as I have one of London's very own on our show today. Roland Chesters is the author of Ripples from the Edge of Life. And Roland, you've got quite the story to share as well, because, you know, on the Whole Care Network, we're all about story sharing. And I appreciate you coming on today to talk about your book and to talk about your story with you and your partner, Richard. So welcome to Healing Ties.
Thank you very much, Chris. Thank you for inviting me and for having me here.
This is great to connect. And that's the wonders of social media, as we touch base. I can't remember if it was Facebook or Twitter, but I'm glad that we have. And as I've learned a little bit about you and followed the publication of your book, but enough of me trying to explain that. Why don't you let our listeners know a little bit about your background, talk about your book, and then we'll get into it.
Thank you, Chris. So I am a gay man who is very rapidly approaching one of the big zeros in life and trying not to look forward to it. I have been happily partnered to Richard now for 21 years, which, as you know, in gay talk means something like 140 years.
That's right. Very much so.
My telegram from the Queen, but it hasn't arrived yet. But 12 years ago, I was diagnosed with HIV and AIDS. And at that time, I was told that I had 2 weeks to live. And being given that kind of news, I suppose, does have an impact on one's life. It does make you reevaluate what is important, what is less important. It makes you reprioritize. Being aware that we are all finite, we all have a use-by date, but many don't know or don't wish to know what their use-by date is. I guess I was lucky in a sense, in that I was told mine. 12 years on, I'm still here. And it has been an interesting journey, to use an overused word. Mm-hmm. And I decided to make use of that journey in order to help others who have gone or are going or are facing a similar journey by writing my book. The book is not only the story of my journey, but I also reached out to the wider HIV community here in the UK. And I have 13 other wonderful people who volunteered to contribute their narratives as well. And I use the word narratives because one of the contributors said to me very pointedly, don't call it a story. Stories, sometimes people think of them as works of fiction. These are real people's lives. And they don't all have happy endings.
Well, you know, stories are really, at least from my point of view, is what connects people. And I certainly understand the point that you made with one of your guests in the book about, it's more than a story. At least for me, and what we try to do on the network is, you know, story sharing is where diversity meets the road to combat a common cause. And by you having the ability to share your story and then bring 13 other people on with you, I mean, what an impact your book is making in in sharing your journeys?
Well, for me, the purpose of, there were several purposes behind writing a book. One of them was just to get it out of my system. It was a cathartic process. Yes. And a painful one at times, because obviously it brought back memories of some pretty dark times. Mm-hmm. But the bigger point was to try and put a dent into the stigma that still surrounds HIV and AIDS. The amount of misinformation that is, the degree of mythology that still exists, or the level of ignorance. And ignorance is not a nice word. I use it deliberately, meaning that people don't have access to the information, not that they are deliberately ignorant. Mm-hmm. But because of that, levels of stigma are still pretty high. And the HIV community as a whole tends to not want to raise its head above the parapet because of that stigma. So by enabling myself and 13 other brave people, as I have said, to put our heads above the parapet and say, look, here we are. This is what it has meant for us. We are still here. Do not be scared. Do not be angered. Come and talk to us. Hopefully that will help to remove some of that mythology and reduce levels of stigma.
You said a word earlier that just really resonated with me, cathartic. You know, writing, there is a sense, at least from my experience when I was writing about my partner's diagnosis with cancer, how cathartic it was to be able to have the outlet, to put words onto paper, even if they didn't make any sense to somebody else, they made sense to me because it was a relief. Just to have that outlet. And I'd be curious to learn, to hear from you about when you were writing the book, and that word you use, cathartic, where how it helped you move along in the process.
Well, I have to admit, Chris, I am not proud to be able to say I used a ghostwriter to put the book together.
Okay.
My AIDS diagnosis was progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy. And after 12 years, I still have to remember to put the teeth in the right way to be able to say that.
Goodness, yes.
And that's a brain disease, which usually has a 5 to 10% survival rate. Mm-hmm. In my case, it affected the cells at the base of my brain, which are the ones that govern motor skills. So it essentially paralyzed me. I had lost the use of my arms, my legs, the ability to speak, and a lot of memory. And it's all kind of scrambled up there. And so I didn't think that I had the ability to write coherently about all that happened to me in a consecutive sequential flow. Mm-hmm. So I reached out and I found a wonderful chap, ghostwriter, who came and spent a lot of time sitting on my sofa with his little tape recorder, asking me questions. And I would just open up and let it all out. And he absorbed it all, took it all away, rewrote it so that it made sense, which is great. Mm-hmm. And the book is the end product of that. So the catharsis for me, it was, I guess, not quite counseling, not quite psychotherapy intervention. But it was just letting it all pour out. And some stuff poured out that I had never let go of before, since. And as I said, parts of it were very painful. Mm-hmm. But having done it, having got that out, kind of having opened the wound, lifted off the scab, it's now healed cleaner and better than it was before.
And the ability to help other people through your journey has to make you feel good as well.
Absolutely. And whilst the book is obviously about being diagnosed with HIV and AIDS, I think this is a journey that could be common to other people who are diagnosed, who receive other traumatic diagnoses. The methodology, the way that people respond, the way that people react and manage those kind of situations, I'm sure is pretty common to many of those kind of diagnoses. So even though the book is essentially about HIV and AIDS, Mm-hmm. I think there are things in there that could apply to many other people.
I share a quick little story with you, if you don't mind. When my partner Richard was diagnosed with esophagus cancer, this would have been 2011, and he had stepped out of the room with the doctor, and I just pulled the doctor aside and I said, "Doctor, how much time are we looking at here?" And he said, 3 to 4 months max. Let him enjoy his life, do whatever he wants to do." And I, at that point, I made the conscious decision not to tell him.
Mm.
And because I knew that he was a fighter, and I wanted to see how the treatments were going for the least the next 3 or 4 weeks. And he started to respond very positively. And I waited, and then he ended up living 29 months past his original diagnosis.
Wow.
And on his year anniversary, I had told him, I said, "Well, you know, the oncologist had told me that you had 3 to 4 months to live, and I made the decision not to tell you because I wanted to see how you were doing."
Mm-hmm.
I would have told you if you wouldn't have shown signs of getting better. But, you know, he looked at me, and it was, I remember this like it was yesterday. He looked at me, said, "You know, I'm really glad you didn't tell me." And then he also added, he says, "I also know you would have told me if I had not improved." And that's true. And I think it's important that, you know, in sharing these stories, that we come back and we do share the stories, because mm-hmm. the situations are different for everybody.
A little bit from the book, which I explained.
Yeah, very much so.
Mm-hmm. The book. So this is the prologue of the book, and it starts off Friday, 1st of December, 2006. I stared out the carriage window as a 1753 from Waterloo Station rattled towards Surbiton, the grimy sprawl of South London rapidly giving way to the leafier parts of Surrey. I could almost set my watch to the time we passed certain landmarks, shops, offices, houses, stations, parks. It was all so familiar, so horribly, boringly familiar, and I felt drained and exhausted with it all. Thank goodness, then, that from tomorrow I had a 2-week holiday in the Italian lakes to look forward to. I knew that by the time I arrived home, Richard, my partner, would have packed the bags, printed the tickets, and unearthed the passports. All I had to do was turn up, which was just as well, because I was capable of little else. For months and months, I'd felt unwell. Nausea, poor balance and coordination, loss of control over arm and leg movements, tetchiness, exhaustion, and incoherent speech were all part of my daily life. I'd had test after test and scan after scan, with no clear diagnosis of what was wrong with me. Whatever it might be, it was tearing my mind and body apart. What was it? No one seemed to know. I just had to get on with it. The day before, I'd had an HIV test on the recommendation of a specialist who'd been examining my lungs for nodules. It was about the only test I hadn't had, and the one I felt was the least necessary. I arrived home to find my mother and brother being attended to by Richard. My mother adored Richard, and because she lived close by, she would frequently call on us, particularly if we were going away. We chatted, and once they finished their coffee, they made moves to go, wishing us a good holiday. After the front door had clicked to, I went into the bedroom, expecting to find everything I needed for the holiday ready and waiting. Except this time, there were no clothes on the bed to pack, and no suitcase in which to pack them. I went into the living room, where Richard was sitting in silence. "Don't you think we should start packing?" I said. "If we leave it any longer, we'll end up in a panic." In response, Richard beckoned to me to sit on the sofa and pointed to the seat next to him. Puzzled, I sat down. Then he hugged me and started to cry. I was shocked. He's a big, strong man, physically and emotionally, and not given to floods of tears. What on earth was going on? "What is it?" I asked. "What's happened? Is it serious? Is it bad news from home?" "Richard's family are thousands of miles away in Barbados." But he shook his head. "It wasn't them. It's us," he said. "We aren't going away, Roland. We can't. I'm so sorry." "Why? Why can't we?" the specialist rang, the one who did the test yesterday. He wanted your office number because... Because what? Because he said that we can't go away. The test results came back. You're positive. HIV positive. You're really ill. If we go to Italy, if we do, you won't come home alive. I'm so sorry.
Wow.
Richard that told me.
Richard told you.
And it turns out that when the specialist phoned to get a hold of my office number to call me to say, don't go away, Richard said to him, no, I'll tell him when he comes home. And out of all of this that has happened, that is my one biggest regret, that the man that I love placed himself in a position of having to give me that news. And I don't know if the roles have been reversed or whether I would have been capable of doing that, to be honest.
That's a very beautiful rendition of that story. And to be able to share that with the two of you. I've had the privilege of talking to caregivers across the spectrum. And one thing that resonates, and it came through in the excerpt that you just read in your book, is those tender moments between two people, whether they're husband and wife, husband and husband, wife and wife, brother and sister, when they're sharing a story, especially as it relates to a diagnosis. There's that sense of, the commitment is not the right word, but I want to say love, care, and commitment that you just demonstrated, which is so important.
I consider myself to be incredibly lucky. I do lots of voluntary work in the HIV sector nowadays, and I know of many relationships that have unfortunately fallen apart when one of the people has been diagnosed with HIV.
Yeah.
Richard has stood by me through all of this. We had our civil partnership less than 2 years after I was diagnosed, and we'd been kind of thinking about it before I was diagnosed, but we went ahead, and as it was getting near to the day of that civil partnership ceremony, I was saying to Richard, are you sure you want to go through with this? Do you really want to be tied for the rest of your life to someone whose future is at best uncertain? And Richard, who is very practical and very pragmatic, would just turn around to me and say, shut up, let's just get on with it.
I love him already.
There
you go. So, another thing that comes to mind here is, and we talked a little bit before we went live with the podcast, is the perceptions of HIV and AIDS, that some people think that it's changed, some people think that it hasn't changed, but I would imagine there's got to be some differences and nuances as it relates to how this disease is perceived and dealt with both in our different countries.
I think probably from the UK perspective and looking across the pond at what's happening in the States, and this is not a political statement of any kind, but for me, probably the biggest difference is that at the moment, at least in the UK, our access to treatment is free. Mm-hmm. We pay through taxes, obviously, but all the medication and so on, the medical support we get is free. And again, I consider myself to be incredibly lucky in a country where that is the case. I have received incredible medical support throughout all of this. And for me, that is one of the biggest differences. Obviously, our HIV community in the UK is much smaller than the American community because we are a smaller population.
Right.
But from what I gather, from what I see, because of the difficulties of accessing treatment in the States, it is a much more fragile community over there than we have over here. Physically, emotionally fragile, potentially more vulnerable as well because of that.
The whole healthcare issue in the United States is so complicated. But when I to hear exactly what you just said about the access to medical care, and it's free. And of course, I understand the taxes are a little bit are higher, but just to have the access, that's got to have some comfort, because as a former social worker and having the privilege to interact with people with a variety of illnesses, and knowing that one of their struggles was always, how am I going to get the medicine?
Yeah.
How am I going to get treated? And to have that burden off your shoulders has to help.
Absolutely. And for me, working within the wider disability community, people with disabilities tend to fall into two groups, hugely stereotyping here, but there are those who become a victim and allow themselves to become a victim, and those who say, no, this is not going to define me. I am still going to go out there and be who I am. And having that issue of thinking about where am I going to access treatment, how am I going to pay for it, and so on and so forth, I would imagine makes it much easier for a newly diagnosed person to get into that victim mentality rather than the I'm going to fight this mentality.
Yeah. And I think that's another example why it's so important, as people feel comfortable, not only to tell their story, but to reach out and allow people to help them. And if I think I heard this correctly, and you're kind of now an advocate for folks as well, especially with the book.
Yeah, I am. But one of the issues we have here in the UK, and I'm sure it's probably similar in the States as well, is the degree of discrimination potentially that HIV people receive from the medical support workers. Mm-hmm. Can I read you another brief excerpt?
Oh, very much so. Thank you. Yes. Mm-hmm.
This is quite a short one. You'll be pleased to know. And this is about my dentist. So I've been seeing the same dentist for many years before my diagnosis, being treated for, amongst other things, gum disease, which is very common amongst HIV-positive people. A few months after my diagnosis, I returned to continue my treatment. She started off by asking the same routine questions about medication, and I gave her the names of the new medicines I was now taking. She disappeared into a back room, and after a few moments, sidled back in, clutching a copy of a medical encyclopedia. "You do realize," she whispered to me. Why she was whispering, I have no idea. We were the only two people in the room. "That these are medications for HIV. For one brief, fleeting moment, I was sorely tempted to deliver an Oscar-winning demonstration of horror, shock, and grief, rolling prostrate on the laminate floor, sobbing pitifully but manfully. No, no, this cannot be. However, common sense prevailed, and I revealed that I was indeed aware of the fact. That being the case," she continued, "I am not able to treat you. Well, not now. You'll need to return at the end of the surgery so that we can be sure the practice is appropriately sanitized before the next day." I was shocked and left there hearing my leper's bell clanging in my ear, unclean, unclean. I did return at the end of surgery, but only to inform her that I would no longer be a patient of hers. If she had no confidence in her clinical procedures, then how could I be confident of not catching something from any of her other customers with a highly infectious condition of which she was not aware?
Right. Oh, my goodness. Oh, what a poignant story. Yes.
And sadly, I now know that here in the UK, at least, I don't know what it's like in the States, but that situation is not uncommon.
It's not uncommon. I think it is a 61-year-old fellow here who grew up in kind of a strict Catholic background where authority was all knowing and all seeing, and we never question authority. As I've grown out of that, and I hear the story from you as well, I think, you know, people who have titles like a doctor, clergy, they're not all knowing.
No.
That's why it's so important to be able to speak up and educate those who have been educated.
Absolutely.
And that's exactly what you did.
But there have been astonishing advances over the last 18 months or so in the treatment of HIV and AIDS, both in the States and here in the UK, in terms of U equals U. Do you know what U equals U means, Chris? Do you know what it stands for?
I have a thought, but I want to hear it from the person who knows.
U equals U means undetectable, means uninfectious. So undetectable means that whenever my blood is tested to see how much of the HIV is still there, because of the medication I take every day, regularly, at the same time, the viral load, the amount of virus I have in my bloodstream is so low that it can't be detected by the measuring instrument. So it's undetectable. And there have been numerous studies that have been done, the partnership study and so on and so forth, over the last few years, assessing couples where one person was HIV positive and the other one wasn't, both gay and straight couples, who had sex without condoms or any other kind of prophylactics and didn't become infected because a HIV partner was undetectable. So it can now be said with 100% certainty that a HIV positive person who is undetectable because they are taking their medication will not infect the person that they are having sex with. And that's wonderful. Mm-hmm. That's liberating.
Yes.
But a lot of people haven't heard that message, don't understand that message, or don't want to hear it or understand it.
And they're afraid of that message.
They are. Yes.
Mm. Yeah. Well, you're doing such a great job in sharing your story and,
and
educating people, because it's important for people to understand that there is help out there, and by sharing your story, you're giving people just a little bit more encouragement to share theirs.
I hope so. It's hugely empowering to be able to share one story, to be able to stand up there and say, this is who I am, like it or lump it, I'm not going to change. And if you perceive me differently because of what I'm telling you, then that is your issue for you to do.
That's right. Very good. Goodness, Roel, I could talk to you for hours. This is terrific. But we've just got a couple of minutes left in the show. Our listeners know how they can find you on the internet, purchase your book. I think I saw you doing a speaking event. Did I see that on Facebook?
I do lots of different speaking events.
Yeah.
But the best way to find me and to find out more about the book is I run my own business, and it's through my business website. Mm-hmm. So my business is called Luminate, Luminate. And the website is www.luminate.uk.com. And on that website, there is a page specifically about the book. And those people who would like to order a copy, that's where they can do it from. Or you can get hold of the book through Amazon as well.
Okay. And tell our listeners a little bit about Luminate.
I am a disability development consultant. So I work with individuals, coaching individuals, adults who become disabled later in life, and are working to somehow normalize that situation for themselves, usually through employment. I work with organizations that want to become more disability aware, disability friendly. And I work with big charities that support people with disability.
Well, I think your middle name is advocacy. Because you are certainly an advocate, not only for people with HIV and AIDS, but after learning a little bit more about your business, goodness, you are an advocate for others. It's an honor to know you.
Thank you, Chris. I appreciate that. But that makes my initials RAC, which here in the UK stands for the Royal Automobile Club.
I'm sure my listeners in the UK will get that one really well. But Roland, goodness, the work that you're doing with your book and with Luminate, you are certainly someone who's creating healing ties all around us. I can't thank you enough for joining me today. We're going to do this again real soon.
I look forward to it.
what a delight to have Roland on the podcast today, especially on World AIDS Day, December 1st, 2018. You know, World AIDS Day is important because it reminds the public and government that HIV has not gone away, and there's still a vital need to raise money, increase awareness, to fight prejudice, and improve education. And Roland's certainly doing that by sharing his story. And what a great story it is. As you know, I'm Chris McClellan, the Bowtie Guy. I'm creating a life to love after caregiving ends through radio writing, travel, advocacy, and being with awesome people like Roland Chesters. Healing Ties is a part of the Whole Care Network. We'll see you for another episode again real soon. Bye-bye.